The struggle between good and evil has been with us a long time, and it's not likely to be going away anytime soon.
But I'd like to think that if we remember the past and some of the truly evil things we failed to stop, well, then maybe the good in us has a decent chance to survive.
Almost everyone knows the story of Anne Frank, the young Jewish girl who perished during Hitler's Holocaust. She left behind a diary which inspired millions the world over.
Fewer people knew about Emmett, a young black boy, just about the same age as Anne, was tortured and lynched in Muddy, Mississippi. His brutal murder helped change the course of American history. Imagine Anne.
And Emmett.
Me.
In a place called memory.
What might they say to each other?
Would they have anything in common to share?
Or have any lessons for us?
What happens if we don't listen to their voices?
Are we simply doomed to repeat the past?
What if we don't even remember? You mean this old thing?
No, it's my favorite.
Uh-huh.
Ah!
There. Peel me back, get the sun off that pretty face of yours. You stay out of the sun, all right?
Okay. I love you, Mama. I gotta go now. Goodbye.
Yes, the rules. I'll say the rules. No laughing, no joking.
is not living, but we are still alive. That is the one thing you must remember, Anne. We are still alive.
Papa, how much longer do we have to wait?
Not long. Soon the British and Americans will come. I'm sure of it. We continue to get reports. Soon they will come for us. We just have to be a little more patient.
I want to be a writer, Papa. A famous one. Yes, I write all my private thoughts in the diary you gave me, but I want so much more. I want to write novels, poems, and plays. And you know I can't do all that cramped up in here. I need to be free.
I know. I know how talented you are. And one day you will be free, and you'll touch the sky with your pen. But right now, it's too dangerous for any of us to be seen or heard. My precious angel, and I will never let them harm you. I will always protect you.
You promise?
I promise. And one day you will see all of your dreams will come true. Promise. I don't know how much longer we can hide. The Gestapo are getting closer all the time, and I know what they will do when they find us. I served as an officer in the German army once. What good will that do you, huh? Give me a medal on my way to the gas chamber. But if the Americans don't come soon, I speak the truth. Hope is the only thing we have left.
Someone to think about you, to remember you, and therefore you are. You exist. So as long as they keep thinking about you.
What happens when they stop? Do I get to leave you?
You'll disappear. Just like chalk being erased from a blackboard. As if you've never lived at all.
So I don't have a choice whether I'm going to stay or leave?
Not any more than I do.
Well, how will I know when I'll let you leave?
First, the lights start to flicker. Then dim. Then it's back to the darkness.
How come you know so much about this place?
Maybe because I've been here longer, been remembered by lots more people.
You said you have no choice either about staying or leaving. You want to stay here?
Yes. I want to stay here as long as possible. I want people to remember me. Forever.
But I don't understand why anyone would want to think of us here together. I mean, it's kind of hard to imagine.
Imagine! That's it! Someone must have thought of us here together, that we were connected in some way.
Come on, you're a white girl. I'm a black boy. What will we have in common?
I don't know. Maybe someone thought we had to talk about our lives, how we got here, and why. Maybe something happened to us when we were still young. There's a reason. All I know is that we probably don't have much time together. Memory fades. It doesn't last very long.
You said that it's timeless.
I said the truth was timeless, not memory. So, why don't we start over? My name's Anne. And Frank, and you are?
Emmett. Emmett Hill.
Why do you keep moving away? Are you afraid of me?
I'm not afraid of anybody.
Then why do you keep...
Rules? I'm not supposed to.
There are no rules here. You're totally free. I think you're just shy around girls.
I have plenty of girlfriends.
Well, no, sure you do. They're special to me. I was frightening them.
Looks real special on the floor.
But you came in and spoiled everything.
Well, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to crash in.
Well, I certainly didn't invite you here. You really shouldn't be here. You need to go.
Then be forgotten.
Sorry. I know it's not up to you to leave. I didn't mean
to be mean.
No. It's just that there's this dream I have. I try to put it into parts, exactly as it happened, but every time I get close, it's eluding me, slipping away. I just about had it when you interrupted me.
I was so important about a dream. Can't you just have another one?
No, not like this one. It was so...
So? Who's kid?
She's my best friend.
Where is she?
In my diary. Huh? Kitty was the one person who I used to tell all of my secrets to. The one person who wouldn't judge or criticize me or betray my thoughts or moods. I didn't have to pretend I was happy when I was miserable.
Was she a real person?
No, not to me.
Why did you call her Kitty?
After my beautiful cat, Martha. Martha.
You had a cat named Martha. So, whatever happened to Martha, the cat?
I don't know. We had to leave her behind when we were forced to hide from the Nazi. It's a long story.
That's okay. Just tell me as much as you can.
Well, I was born in Germany. It was a beautiful country, rolling hills, fields of flowers. We had a lovely home there. It was full of books and music. My father loved to read.
I voted Anne and Margaret to study all the great minds. I used to read them. French, German, English.
Sounds like you had a pretty nice life.
Yes, it was wonderful. Until Hitler and the Nazi came to power, they turned everyone against us.
Us?
Those of us who were Jewish.
How come? What did you do?
We didn't do anything.
Then how come Hitler turned the Nazi against you?
Because we were Jewish. Die Juden sehen unseren Glück.
Die what?
It's German. It meant all our misfortunes and the fault of the Jews. It was written on all the posters, all the papers.
Misfortunes? I always heard that the Jewish people were the chosen people. I never knew what that meant, but it sounded like something good, something special.
You are chosen, all right. For special persecution, special suffering, made slaves in Egypt, burned at the stake during the Spanish Inquisition.
So the Nazi decided that they had one final solution for us.
Yes.
but most countries wouldn't let us in. There was a German ship, the MS St. Louis. It had more than 900 Jewish passengers on board, all trying to immigrate to Cuba.
What happened to them?
The Cuban government let few people get off the ship, but the rest had nowhere else to go. They begged to land in America, but they were turned away because there was a law, a strict policy on admitting immigrants.
An American president treated white folks like that?
Yes, Emmett. It was shameful, unspeakable, because everyone knew what the Nazis were doing, so just didn't care enough to stop them.
But I thought that Roosevelt was a good man, especially after Hoover. Hard to believe he turned all those people away. But you got out?
Yes, to Holland.
Were you safe there?
At first, but the Nazi kept invading country after country in Europe. Holland too, even separating families. Papa was my favorite person.
How about your mother?
My mother? Well, there were times when I hated her.
My mother? She was my best friend. You hated your mother?
She was always criticizing me. My older sister, Margot, was her favorite. Margot could do no wrong. But I was the one mother always picked on. I could never be the person that I really was. Papa was the only one who understood me. He tried to hold it all together, but it was hard. We were always in each other's way, each other's mood. Honestly, it was so exasperating. The others didn't like it when I talked, or when I said nothing. If I was tired, they said I was lazy, or I could never be smart, just cunning or clever.
Well,
when I was serious, they thought I was joking. When I was joking, they thought I was serious. Everything I did seemed to antagonize them. They even called me a chatter box.
No kidding.
There were times when I wished I had been born with a different personality.
Then you wouldn't have been you.
Yes, but...
Oh, life's been me. Liked cracking jokes all the time, trying to make people laugh. Everybody thought I was pretty funny. Shoot, maybe that's the advantage of being on the top.
That's the advantage of not being stuck in an attic.
You mean panics?
Touche. Touche, it's French, it means you got me. I guess I am showing off.
You don't have to impress me.
It's just, it was all so depressing. I used to find a place where I could just be alone and write, just so I could talk to it.
Jenny.
Exactly. I still miss her, and I'm still mad.
How come?
They let Egypt in his patent annex. It was used to cast rats. They kept urinating everywhere. Do you know what pipe print smells like?
Nope.
It smells like fear. The smell of fear was in our clothes, our hair, our hands. It was everywhere, in everything. We couldn't just wash it away. Then the plumbing stopped, we were trapped.
I'll never have to live cooped up like that.
Being cooped up was better than being captured. We knew what the Nazis were doing to our people. Sending them off to concentration camps and railroad cars packed in like cattle. When they arrived at the camps, they separated everyone. Husband from wife, mother from child, old from young, weak from strong. And they counted and numbered everything. Clothes, shoes, jewelry, people. Especially people. They tattooed our arms with numbers. They stripped us of everything, anything we had of value. They took off our wedding bands and hauled them away in wheelbarrows.
Even took the gold out of the teeth of the dead.
really took the gold from their feet.
There wasn't anything they wouldn't do. One of the first things they did was cut off everyone's hair. Imagine cutting off all the hair of all the women and girls and using it for matches stuffing.
My mother, she always told me that a woman's hair is her crown and her glory. They used it for
matches stuffing. They claimed it was for health reasons. It's rid of lice and thing. But it wasn't health. It was humiliation. Make everyone just another number. Then there were the experiments. Joseph Mengele, the angel of death. He put people in pressure chambers, measured their tolerance for pain. He took 10 children and drew blood from them until they died.
I had no idea what was going on. What the Nazis were doing to your people.
Emmett,
Why would they do this to you?
Different color skin, I guess.
Your skin? It's darker, different, but there has to be more to it than color. Come on, let's compare. What's wrong?
That's how I got into trouble.
There's no trouble here.
Maybe not, but... What happened to your arm?
Nothing.
Hey, you have a tattoo?
Let's talk about you, Emmett. I still don't understand why the whites hated you.
So now you only explain why we were hated?
No, I mean...
They didn't hate us at first. They just wanted us to do all the work for them for nothing. Later, they feared us, saw how strong we were, and they felt weak, inferior physically. So they had to hold us down, down and back. Prevented us from learning how to read and write, and then claimed that we were dumb when we couldn't read or write.
So they could keep you down, dominate you.
Exactly.
So Nazi feared us too, but since they couldn't dominate us, they wanted to destroy us.
Destroy you and dominate us.
You know, it's so absurd. I'm white and Jewish.
I'm black and Christian.
But they came for both of us. It wasn't about religion or color, like you said. It was fear.
But why does everyone have to fear anything and everyone was different?
Maybe it's people need to think they're better than someone else. And once they realize they're not...
You know, Anne, the thing about fear is... I think it's really just about hate. I mean, when someone says that they acted out of fear, they think that it makes it more acceptable, but really, what's this all about me?
But I can never understand it. Everyone loved our music, our art, our dedication to science, medicine, law. We've given so much to the world. I've always wondered, what would the world be like without us? Albert Einstein. Oh, I can count hundreds. Jonas Salk, the doctor who created the cure for polio.
Salk. Read about him, all right? Guess he came a little too late for me.
What do you mean, late for you?
I got polio when I was 6 years old. It affected my speech somehow. It made me stutter.
Oh, I didn't know polio could cause stuttering, but you're okay now?
Usually only happens when I'm nervous. Everything in memory seems to be all right, though. You know, Ed, you know that thing you said about what Jewish people have given the world? What would America, the world for that matter, be like without our feeling? Our music, our art, our science? Frederick Douglass, George Washington Carver, W.E.B. Du Bois, Judge Justice Thurgood Marshall, America was built on our backs, but when we decided to resist, demand equal rights, they said, if you don't like how things are, you need to go back to Africa.
So Nazi felt the same way about us, Emmett, but they couldn't send us anywhere. We didn't have a place to go back then.
You said back then, but now?
Now, we have our own country, a place that's ours, the land God promised us.
After all this happened, you still believe in God?
Yes. It's important to have something to believe in. To have a religion. It doesn't matter what religion, Jewish, Christian, as long as you believe.
Did Hitler believe? Did he have a religion?
He was Catholic, but the only thing he practiced was Nazism.
But you still have faith?
I'm not naive about what you're implying. I know the world is not full of jelly beans and cotton candy.
Be careful not when you talk about that car.
Despair. That's the alternative, isn't it? Well, not for me. I still believe that mankind is basically good.
Basically good? Wars, famine, slaughter?
Sure, there's all of that. But there are people who perform 1,000 acts of kindness every day. Yes, goodness.
What do you see when you look in the eyes of the Nazi?
Hate. Evil.
That's my point. There's just as much hate and evil in the world as there is goodness. Maybe more. You know, man, there's something I never understood. I've always praised God. I prayed to Him. I promised to be good, and mostly I was. But when I needed Him the most, He wasn't even there for me.
I pray too, but I think we may have been asking for too much. I mean, I think that God must listen to hundreds of millions of us at every moment.
But what's a God for if He doesn't listen or hears us when we need Him the most?
Well, I'm not sure if a God is in he or she for that matter.
Oh, man.
As if God is a metaphor, a power that creates, gives life.
And then what, moves off to some other planet? I had a landlord like that growing up. Absentee landlords never made any repairs, just let things go.
It's complicated, Emmett. I don't have all the answers.
But if God is so perfect, then how can He create something so imperfect? How can He allow such hate to...
I don't know! Sometimes I wonder if evil is just some dark force floating around the universe waiting to enter the human heart.
Evil needs us to...
To feed off of it and to grow stronger with every act of cruelty.
Evil needs us to live.
Maybe it's people need evil so that we can know kindness, decency. Maybe we can never truly appreciate perfection if everything is already perfect.
Now that's heaven. You know, now you sound like one of those philosophers you talk about. No day without night. No love without hate. So hate and murder has to be with us or them?
No. Not always. They don't always have to be hating. Not if they're willing to recognize evil before it goes too far. I still believe that the good people of the world will stop the hatred. And that's how we survived over the centuries.
Our traditions were ripped away from us on slave ships and auction blocks.
Replaced by their traditions.
Culture, food, holidays.
But we learned to love them.
Especially Christmas.
Thank you.
divide us from one another, then against each other. Field slave against house slave, dark skin against light skin. It was all so.
It seems got better for you, didn't it?
I don't know. Everything's dark after me.
After what?
What happened to me?
What happened? Tell me.
I don't like talking about it.
Don't you want to know? To see if things changed, got better? Memory allows you to do that.
It's too hard.
You have to try. Try harder. What do you see? What do the people who think about you allow you to see?
There's a woman. She's sitting on a bus. She's thinking of me.
What is she thinking? Tell me what you hear.
Her name is Rosa. Rosa Parks. She just keeps saying, I was gonna sit there for you, Emmett. For you. I wasn't gonna move. I just couldn't do it. My feet weren't sore. I wasn't tired. I was gonna stay there for you, Emmett. For you. She won't give up a seat for a white man who goes to the back of the bus. People are united, marching, boycotting. There's a preacher, Dr. Martin King, getting involved. He's got a strong voice and he really preached. He's got people fired up. People are marching in the streets, eating at lunch counters, getting beaten up, chased by dogs, firebombed. Some people want to fight back, fire for fire, but Dr. King says that they must remain nonviolent no matter what those racists do. It's a war. People are fighting back, marching, calling my name. My name. Emmett Till. Emmett Till.
Oh, what sorrow. Oh, what pity. Oh, what pain that tears and blood should mix like rain. And terror come again to Mississippi.
The poem by Langston Hughes about me. They're calling my name. Calling my name. Emmett Till. Emmett Till. It's a right. German prisoners of war ended up being treated better than us.
You're not serious.
Yes, I am. German officers could eat and drink at officer clubs, but black officers were arrested and tossed in jail for demanding those same rights, even court-martialed. Jackie Robinson, baseball great, was one of them. Such a shame. Black officers are afraid of wearing their uniforms out in public outside for fear of being beaten or lynched. Any white person, even a Nazi, is considered better than an Indian.
Emmett, and you're angry, I understand that. Anger only eats away in time. It doesn't change anything. Just remember that while you were trying to get to officer clubs, we were trying to stay out of the oven.
You're right. Anger doesn't change anything. It just scares people whenever we let the rage out.
I don't understand. Why can't you
wait?
See? What is it?
Holy moly! I've never thought I'd ever see this before in my entire life!
What is it?
There's a black person in the White House. Not a slave or a servant, but the president of the United States!
See, things do get better. Progress has been made.
Whoa. One black man made it to the top, and so now we have nothing to worry about. Racism is dead. We're all equal now.
And that's not what I said. And you don't believe that anymore with the Jewish president, and anti-Semitism will be dead. All I'm saying is that progress has been made. Why can't you accept that?
Real easy for you to talk about acceptance.
Meaning what?
Meaning things are easier for you now.
Oh, well, things weren't so easy for me in Germany.
Maybe not, but in America, you have been made in the shade. All you have to do is change your name. Change your name and you can pass. In America, your religion isn't as important as what color you are. And in America, your people get to be white.
So you're comparing who suffered more?
No, I'm not saying that. We're both dead. I'm just saying that in America, your color is a prison. If you're white, you're all right. And if you're black, get back.
I like your hat on
you. I've always liked wearing it. From the time I was 4 or 5, I guess it made me feel older. Like a man. I was always in such a rush to grow up. Never knew that the future would come so soon. That my life would end so soon.
You still haven't told me what happened to you. You need to talk about it.
I told you I don't like talking about it.
You have to tell me.
I was living in Chicago. It was the summer of 1955. I was going to visit my cousins and Uncle Moses down in Mississippi. They were working at a big plantation down there. My mama didn't want me to go. She was worried about me.
Why not?
She said I didn't know all the rules.
Rules?
Just like the Nazi had rules for you, the white man had rules for us. And about a year earlier, 9 white men on the Supreme Court ordered that blacks were entitled to an equal education, just like the white folks. And at first, I was excited about going to school with the white kids, just to see how they would talk. But that decision made a lot of white folks angry. My mother always warned me to be real careful when it came to white folks. Be sure to call them manners, and be sure to call them sir, ma'am, and always step on the sidewalk when one of them passes. Especially the white. My cousins told me to be afraid, to scatter, and run, like you're on a plantation serving master. But I was from Chicago. I was from the North. I was gonna show them that when we didn't do all that, I wasn't afraid of nobody.
Gosh, Emmett, what did you do? That's it? You whistled?
Yeah, whistled at a white
woman. I mean, didn't you know that
it was just a dumb mistake. I was just joking around. And it cost me my life. I don't want to go back there. It's too painful. I want to forget.
No, I mean, you can't forget. You have to tell me what happened.
When I whistled, my cousins scattered and ran towards the car. They knew we were in trouble. They were so afraid they didn't talk the whole car ride home. None of us could sleep that night. The next morning, nothing happened, so we thought we were safe. But then a few nights later, some men showed up to my Uncle Moses' place looking for me. Said they were gonna teach me a lesson. They took an axe to me. Oh!
Even though I was scared of her.
What's a good day of cotton to fail? Time to go up my bed. They shot me in the head. They threw me in the towel. Everything went blank. The last thing I could hear was the sound of her laughing. My body splashed in the river. Funny, all the time they were beating and cutting me up.
He left town right after, and they'd kill him if they ever found him.
After the trial, the murderers gave an interview to Look magazine.
Well, what else do we do?
In their place.
I know how it works. I just decided it was time a few people got put on notice.
And as long as I'm living or have anything to do with it,
niggas
stay in their place.
Niggas ain't gonna vote where I live if they get in control of the government.
And they ain't gonna go to school with my kids.
And if it never comes close to mentioning sex with a white woman who's tired of living, and I'm likely to kill it.
I just made up my mind. Chicago boy, I said. $4,000 for that interview.
And laughed about how they got away with it.
They did to me.
To my boy.
In America, you can confess to murder and still go free.
If you're white, you bet.
Maybe you should have listened to your mother and your cousins. I mean, you could still be alive today if
I what? Left by the white man's rules? Jumping off sidewalks to let them pass? Licking their boots along the way?
There were places we could go, places that were safe. How was I supposed to know that France, Poland, and all the others would fall so quickly? Or that America would not care? Or come soon enough? I knew that Hitler was a madman, and that nothing straight could ever come from a crooked wood, but who knew how much evil was carved into the twisted cross of a Nazi? Who knew? Who knew?
It was all so surreal.
The summer heat cooled till autumn. The air became colder.
Winter was so bitter.
We were hungry all the time. We had to fight like animals for a scrap of food.
Marco grew weaker.
Quieter.
More distant.
We were starving, all of us.
I was in denial she was starving to death. I became his older sister. I gave her all of my food. I was so determined to keep her alive. She was my only link I had to all that had been so beautiful in the past. She kept growing weaker, but the guards kept giving us more work.
You see the Nazi soldiers smiling, laughing, joking, treating us like vermin, not human, performing cruel experiments, torture, executions, gassings. I will never forget the smell of the smoke of burning souls.
When Marco died, they threw her body into a mass grave. I felt myself giving up. The only thing I had left was hope. And it was fading.
Everyone had typhus. The nausea, scratching pain.
I still held on to hope. I kept thinking of my father, of how much I loved him, how I used to write in my diary. I grew delirious. I knew I was dying, slipping away. Then, I heard a slight tapping sound. Soon became loud thumping. Is it the Dutch police coming for me again? Just the last beats of my heart. The thumping turned into a flopping noise. The light turned bright. And suddenly, I could see. It was that beautiful bird I had dreamt about. I wanted to set it free, to fly with it into the blue skies. See Papa smiling at me as a little girl,
studying my lessons,
to love me sounds more weaker, softer. Then,
I see.
Nothing.
Nothing. Nothing! My God, where were you? My Anna, my Margot, my Edith, my dear family, all those millions of others. Could you not hear our screams? Were they not loud enough for your ears? Could you not see the suffering, the cruelty we had to endure? Or maybe you could not see because you were too far away. Of course, because you had no eyes! Actually, were you angry with us? Tell me about the ashes of the babies thrown into the fire, burned alive in the ovens. Did they displease you? Were they unworthy of your love? Did you let them die as a sign of your love? Is this how a God loves? I hear your silence. Maybe you can only hear me if I recite your prayer. Our Father, who is in heaven, sanctified be your name. Your kingdom, your will be done on heaven and earth. Give to us our bread daily. And forgive us our sins, as forgive we also those who sin against us. And bring us not into the hands of a test. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is your answer, God. Silence. I know you will not forgive my blasphemy, but I will not forget your silence.
Should have spoken.
approach you that way.
No, no, you don't have to apologize. That's why we ought to never allow anyone to try and destroy us. Remember, never again. To remind people the world over what we had to endure. Now, it's a crime in some parts of Europe to promote anti-Semitism, or to say that the Holocaust never happened. You could go to jail just for saying that.
You mean leaders are prosecuted in Europe?
Exactly.
But protected in America?
They can't be.
The Ku Klux Klan and skinheads can march down any main road, praising Hitler, and have a police escort in the process.
Seriously?
They can wrap themselves in American flags while saluting Hitler and burn crosses knowing it's the symbol of white terrorism.
That's terrible. Not only can the haters deny what they did to us, but companies that profited during the Holocaust have to pay restitution to the survivors and their families. Make reparations.
Reparations? You get reparations?
Absolutely. Under the law.
Under the law, we don't get nothing. Not a dime, not a penny. White folks said slavery happened too long ago. They don't know who to pay or how much.
They're wrong, Emmett. Time can't erase the crime against humanity. It's never too late for justice. Seems to me, if scientists can figure out just how long ago the Earth was created, they can figure out just how much it's owed.
A few accountants will do it, and some companies that keep all sorts of records.
Emmett, remember how we did it?
Amy. You tell everybody to remember. Everybody tells us to forget, to stop playing the victim, to stop dragging the past around like some dead body in the cemetery. Bury it. It's history. Black history, I guess. Not American history.
Emmett, I sympathize. I really do.
But
at some point you have to...
What? Get over it? My mother used to quote the Bible all the time about the need for grace and forgiveness.
But you didn't listen to her.
Let's not argue about that again.
I'm not trying to argue, it's just... At some point, you have to let the anger go.
Let it go, baby.
It's just an expression.
Easy for you to say, let the anger go. Europeans are trying to make up for what you mean Hitler did to your people. But who do we have to blame for 300 years of hate? Washington? Jackson? Jefferson? Johnson? It was everybody and no one. Like the police used to say, it all happened under persons unknown. I wish I could let go of the rage and but I can never go back to being that carefree boy I once was. I never forget that night, everything getting dark.
The universe isn't dark enough to snuff out the light of a single candle. I don't remember who said that, but that's what I always try to do. Through all the darkness, all the gloom, I light the candle inside. I think of the candle flickering inside my mind and it makes me smile, have hope, believe that everything I've been through hasn't just been a waste. You should try it, Emmett.
I can't.
Just light a candle.
Maybe one day.
One day means never, and you know that. Come on, just try it. Emmett, you had such a peaceful expression on your face when you lit your candle. What were you thinking?
About my last birthday, I remember blowing out 14 candles and I made a wish. Actually, two.
Hey, that's cheating.
I know. I wish that one day become a professional comedian, like Abbott and Costello, like George Gabel, my favorite.
And the other wish?
Well, if I could make people laugh, then I would become a motorcycle policeman. Be a peacemaker. Stop people from fighting.
I wanted so much to have a 16th birthday party. Excited to open all my beautifully wrapped presents, all my family and friends they're celebrating. I would light all the candles, then making a wish. Just one wish. Blow them all out.
What would you wish for?
You can't tell people your wish or it won't come true. I guess it doesn't really matter anymore, but I would have wished to become a great writer, a poet, playwright, maybe even a movie star.
Hey, that's cheating.
You know, I guess I could have achieved a little too, but I think what I wanted most of all was to change the world, to make it a better place.
If I had lived, I would have done something big, something important, Maybe like Dr. King marched for justice. Yeah, that's what I was wanting. Justice for black people. Something we've never had.
That's why I devoted the rest of my life to giving meaning to your death, Emmett. You changed the course of American history.
And I did the same for you. When I, out of the 8 of us that were sent to the camps, I was the only one who survived. When I discovered that the pages of your diary had not been lost or destroyed, I had them published so all the world would know what life was like for me, for us. I wanted everyone to know the truth.
Emmett, I was just thinking, your name. Emmett is the Hebrew word for truth.
Wow, truth. What does it mean?
Well, in Hebrew, it means favored grace.
So your grace, not truth. But do you think any of it really matters to anyone? I mean, after all we've been through, we're just still in someone else's memory. They don't have to do anything else. All they have to do is think. That's it. They don't have to take any action. We're stuck between remembering history and repeating it.
No. Not just the memories of the horrors of the past become so strong, so deeply embedded in their souls that they say, enough, no more. But memory fades quickly. I think it's happening already.
But we insist with the someone else thought of us, right?
Yes.
Well, if they can imagine us here together, pull us out of the dark into the light, like you say, then why can't we light that same beam of light right back at them? Let them know about them, both of us, that they need to do something. That they need to stop these silent witnesses to crimes that they know are happening, thinking that they're safe.
That's brilliant, Emmett. Yes, you can tell the people of the world that the haters are still out there, and that the good people aren't stepping up, aren't doing enough to stop them.
And the lights out. I think we need to hurry up.
It's too good along.
More Hebrew?
Yes, it's from the Talmud. It means more obligation to repair the world.
That's what we're doing. We're joining forces to prepare the world.
Emmett, do you still want to leave memory?
No. I want to stay here, Anne. Just like you. I want to be remembered forever.
Okay, let's go. Bring our memories to the present and tell the people of the world that they have to stop the hate.
And if they don't, we'll be having the same conversation over and over.
Forget
the dead would be a pity killing them a second time.